a mile. Then around 10 p.m. that night, everything went silent. Steve looked at Ben and Chef and said, "Hey, get ready. I think they're coming in for us." Charlie had this small drone that he flew up into the air just to inspect the area to see what was surrounding the perimeter. And from this bird's eye view, we saw 15 heat signatures all around us. We were surrounded on all angles. But for some reason, they were staying beyond our perimeter. We didn't know what they were going to do next, but I knew one thing. We weren't going out to them. They were going to have to come to us. 10 minutes later, the northern perimeter alarm went off. Then seconds after that, the southern perimeter alarm went off. Then the east and the west perimeter alarms went off. They were moving in. You could feel the ground rumbling as these things ran in at us. They would run just beyond the area of the lights, almost as if they were running zigzag patterns crossing around us. This full speed running back and forth, left and right, north, south, east, and west went on for the next 15 minutes. I think they were checking our defenses for some type of weakness. Then it started. A full-size tree came flying in over our heads, hitting one of our lights and knocking it down. Chef and Kid, who were covering the south, began to fire their weapons. Steve and I began to fire. Ben covered the east while Sisters covered the west. Back to back, with our backs turned to each other, we fired round after round and clip after clip. Charlie huddled in the middle of us with his computer trying to find out what was going on. And he kept calling, "Incoming from the north! Incoming from the south! Incoming from the east!" After what felt like an hour of pure madness, Ben got completely and totally enraged. And I saw him out of the corner of my eye going to his case and grabbing his AA-12 shotgun. Once he began shooting that shotgun, all activity ceased. And high above us, from the area of that same plateau, we heard a scream so loud and so powerful that I knew that this was just a test. The real danger was whatever that thing was at the top of the plateau, screaming and giving orders to these creatures. That we would discover the very next night. The following morning, camp was a mess. 3 out of our 4 lights were destroyed, and they had thrown full-grown trees at us. Charlie started his bitching and moaning about not being safe. He wanted to leave. The little wussy acted like he had a choice in the matter. Steve was clearly perturbed as he walked around the perimeter. "I hit 3 of them in the chest multiple times," he said. "So did I," said Ben. "I hit 2 of them with the AA-12. What was most confusing was that there was no bodies. Vital, who I only saw one time during a firefight, was not in the campsite." When Steve and I realized this, instant panic set in, and we began to look around for any signs of where he might have gone to. Fanning out in all directions, we moved around searching for him. And just as Steve and I began to assume the worst, he signaled us from high in a tree. Now, somehow, during a firefight, he managed to flank these creatures and get well behind them. Vital went on to tell us that he observed them during the fight, that these animals carried their wounded and dead off when they left. He also told us that when they left, they scattered in all directions. Vital believed that this was not just one clan, but it was 4 clans that we were up against. I have to admit, I was impressed. How the hell did he pull this off? And for the first time, I began to think that we had bit off way more than we could chew. A huge part of me wanted to leave, and Vital even said it. "This is a fight we cannot win." But I knew Steve, and we weren't going anywhere. When we returned to camp with Vital, there was this synchronized exhale and a brief moment of relief. But as soon as Charlie started yapping about wanting to leave, the shit hit the fan. Steve grabbed him by the back of the neck, pulling him close, and whispered, "I didn't hire you for your fucking opinion or cowardice. Now get your ass moving and expand our perimeter." To be honest, the overall consensus was that we needed to leave, and Steve knew it. I mean, we fuck with some terrible shit in our time. But 3 to 4 clans of Bigfoots? That was a bit too much. And the intel that we gathered only told us about one violent clan. We didn't even come prepared to deal with more than one clan. And last night, we ran through 35% of our munitions. If they attacked us 2 more times, we were fucked. So I pulled Steve to the side while everybody was cleaning up. And I said, listen, brother, this is getting a little too sticky for us. We might need to think about getting the hell out of here before nightfall. He just looked at me and said, I know. Let's give it 24 more hours. And then we're out of here. I'm going to kill as many of these things as I can. Now, Steve knew this wasn't a good move. I could see it in his eyes. He realized that we were in way too deep. And the bad thing about it is, he wasn't the one that was going to pay the price. I was. We spent the rest of the day preparing defenses. Ben cleared more trees to give us a better line of sight. Karate Kid dug out 2 small ditches within our perimeter and filled them with gasoline as a way of using fire to separate the creatures and provide us more light so we can see. And no one was allowed to venture out from the camp at all. And with good reason. I know I saw 2 of those creatures watching us. They were there for a split second, then gone. At this point in time, I didn't know if we were going to survive the night. But I knew one thing for sure. We were prepared to fight tooth and nail. Smoke bombs, flashbangs, fire traps. This was going to be one night to remember. And by the time darkness fell, the camp was transformed into a target range. Gone were the safari tents and fancy equipment. It was about to go down. There was no fancy meal cooked by a chef that night. Straight up MREs, pinto bean stew is what we had. Shit was awful. Looking back on it, that almost was my last supper. The mood was tense as darkness grew. Everyone knew that tonight was going to be hell. We had no idea what we were about to face. Unlike the night before, things were normal until about 11:30. That's when the woods went silent. It was amazing, almost as if every living creature evacuated the area. Vitor signaled from high above us in a tree to let us know that he was seeing movement. The next thing you know, a freaking boulder comes flying in at us. Now listen, this is not a rock. Rocks are about the size of your hand. This thing was the size of my chest. This was a boulder. It was like God got pissed off at us and it started raining boulders from the sky. I remember looking around and thinking to myself, man, we're in serious trouble. They're going to stay out of shooting range and just throw boulders at us. Just then, Vital began to fire in the opposite direction of where the boulders were coming from. Then he said something that I'll never forget. It's a distraction. Look behind you. By the time I turned around, Vital had begun to open fire full blast, and I could see huge shadows moving towards us. But it was not until Kid lit the first ring of fire that I realized what we were up against. Now I need you for a second to imagine this. As the first ring of fire began to ignite, one by one, the dark shadows surrounding us became clear. It looked like an army. This shit reminded me of something from the ancient days of the Roman Empire. They were all lined up. Some had boulders in their hands. Others had broken trees. I mean full-size trees. It had to be about 30 of these things. The smallest 7 feet tall. Some were male and others were female. Vital stopped shooting for a moment and I swear it was like something out of a movie. From behind the line of creatures stands up this thing. I say it stood up because it had to be squatting down. This creature was 14 feet tall. Its hair illuminated this kind of reddish brown glow by the fire. And this was clearly their leader. Now I'm not bullshitting you. He dwarfed the others as he moved forward to the front of the line. At this point, I'm thinking I'm about to die a horrible death. I could see it in my head, my arms being ripped off, my legs being ripped off, and being eaten alive. And if we had been led by anyone else, we probably would have died that night. I mean, you can feel the fear overwhelming each of us, just like a pitcher left under the faucet running water. And just when we were intimidated, I heard this shot, and I knew it was from him. Steve had just fired his .50 cal Barrett. I watched as the 14-foot-tall Bigfoot was hit dead center in his chest. The creature stumbled backwards for a few steps, bumping into others, then fell on his side. Steve had shot the leader in hopes that the rest of them would become afraid. And for a moment, it looked like it had worked. Until the largest female looked down at their leader, pointed a finger at us, and began to roar. Steve's second shot put a stop to that instantly. I can't tell you exactly where he hit her, but she fell to the ground, squirming, arms and legs flailing about. From that point on, it was non-stop shooting. Chef and Ben popped smoke at our rear to keep them from coming up behind us, while Kid chucked flashbangs into the direction of the others. The sound didn't seem to bother them, but the flash definitely stunned them, allowing us to kill 10 to 15 of these things with ease. The tide had turned in our favor, and I had just thought, man, I might just survive this shit, when I felt the ground shaking beneath my feet. Turning to my left, there it was, moving full speed directly at me with its mouth wide open. It looked like one of those Down syndrome or retard kids we grew up with in school, except it was jet black. In his eyes, I'll never forget those eyes. They weren't set on the front of his head. They were kind of to the side. But the eyeballs actually rolled completely in as it fixed its gaze on me. I was only able to get off one shot before I went flying into the air. And just like on those cartoons where the Hulk throws something in the air and then punches it, well, that was me. And as my body was in mid-air, this thing took two steps forward, swung its forearm in a downward direction, striking my left thigh. I felt the bone break before I hit the ground. I was laying there, in pain, and it was just about to step on me when Ben shot it in the head with that AA-12 shotgun. After the first shot, it was still able to turn and look at him. Then it fell to the ground. From my position on the ground, I fired as many shots as I could. Man, I watched as Charlie was hitting the head with one of those boulders, splitting his skull. Chef was hit by a tree. This thing came flying in like somebody threw a frisbee, knocking him unconscious. Right at about 4:45 in the morning, things went silent. I didn't know if they were preparing for round two or if they had enough. But with three of us down and limited munitions, it was time for us to get the fuck out of Dodge. Ben did his best to tend to my broken femur, and somehow Vital was able to wake Chef up. But Charles, he was gone. There was nothing that could be done for him. With a splint on my leg and some drugs in my system, I was able to stand with assistance. Now able to stand, I witnessed firsthand the carnage. Blood, hair, everywhere. They didn't take the dead with them this time. They left them behind. To be honest with you, this was a massacre. And for the first time, I felt conflicted that day. I'm not sure if it was the drugs or my conscience, but I felt fucked up. We had wiped them out of existence. Or at least so I thought. Steve, ever focused, gave orders for us to start heading back to the boats. We were to leave everything behind except for our weapons and the remaining ammo. There was really nothing left. Everything had been destroyed that night. By the time we reached the river, the sun had fully risen. And again, the sense that we were going to make it out of this alive washed over me. I finally felt secure. That was until I started hearing this sound coming from behind us. It wasn't them coming for us. It was the sound of them weeping, moaning, almost as if they were crying for the loss of their family members. While all that was going on, Kid looked down at his GPS, confused. He said, "The boats are supposed to be here, but according to this, they're 30 feet deep in the river." Steve looked at me and said, "Wait, what? You mean these things sunk our boats?" And in that moment of confusion and fear, the meds wore off. The pain from my leg came rushing back, sending signals to my brain that said, "Bitch, you're hurt and you're in danger." Ben assisted me in sitting down on the ground and walked over to the riverbank. He just stared in the water as if he was Darth Vader and he could use the force to get the boats back. And Steve He just looked at me with this kind of blank stare on his face. Because at that moment, I think he finally realized we were screwed. While we were coming to this realization, all you heard was them screaming and crying in the background. This ordeal was far from over. We had limited ammo and now no transportation.